before Jesus came, building mystery. Live in a church where you sleep with wooden dolls, and you won't give up the search for the ghosts in the halls. Wear sandals in the snow and a smile. Your shadow getting in the way. You're so beautiful, even in the dark. So careful when I'm in your arms, 'cause you're working, building mystery. Holding on, holding it in. Oh yeah, you're working,
very much. Well, for those of you out there in TV land just tuning in, and perhaps I'm Sarah McLachlan anyway, if you didn't see the beginning of the show, this is intimate and interactive. Okay.
I'm
Thanks. Thank you.
Sarah McLachlan and friends. It feels like Vancouver's moved to Toronto for one night. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the environment. We are honored to have Sarah and her friends here in the environment. She is a major star, Sarah McLachlan. The last album sold 5 million copies.
What? No, it didn't.
So we have lots to talk about. We have lots to talk about. We have that. We have the fact that Lilith Fair is about to happen this summer. 30 dates. We also have a brand new album called Surfacing. You'll hear some of the tunes tonight. And you can ask all of the questions of Sarah and the group and of us here in the room. So I get to ask the first question and maybe the last question. So it goes like this. I know that you sometimes have a problem with explaining what the song titles are about. Mm-hmm. But what about album titles? How about giving us some of the background on Surfacing?
Well, Surfacing as a record was probably the most hardest record I ever had to make, and probably because it was the most personal, and I had to do a lot of work on myself to get back to a place where I was comfortable with myself for many reasons. One of the things being that I was on tour for 2.5 years with Fumbling, and I just kind of lost myself completely, and I needed that time afterwards just to sort of rediscover myself, fill up the well, and people always ask me, well, you know, you have a writer's block, and I go, well, that was what the writer's block was. I didn't trust myself. I couldn't write because I was in this place where I didn't know who I was. And I sort of find this perverse pattern reoccurring where I go on tour for a long time and build up all these walls and sort of end up being this tiny little thing, core inside me, that remains intact. And I come home and writing the next record is sort of a process of tearing down all those walls. Yep. And Surfacing, sort of to use a metaphor for, you know, the whole concept is like one of my biggest fears is water at night, being on the edge of a big black lake and the lake being, you know, endless and unknown and very scary. And the whole album was a process of myself throwing myself into it, forcing Whoa. Myself to go there and swim around in it and roll around in it and get submersed and then hopefully surface again and you know, come out a better person, I guess, come out after therapy and such.
That's only the first question.
Just get right into the good, yeah. heavy stuff.
Okay, we'd like to hear your questions. We've showed you how you can talk to us. That's all you have to do. Please join us this evening for an evening of intimate and interactive with Sarah McLachlan and friends in the Much Environment. Toronto, the corner of Queen and John, Much Music, the nation's music station. We have questions from all over and right here, as a matter of fact, here in the studio and out on the street on Queen. What's your name?
Angela.
Where are you from?
Scarborough.
Okay, what's your question?
More and more celebrities are finding that living up to society's expectations are a great pressure. Society either makes celebrities a role model or a negative influence. Did you find yourself at all pressured to portray yourself as the perfect role model?
Well, I do have to, that's a very good question. I do have to say that I for a long time, didn't feel very comfortable being a role model, and probably mostly because a lot of the times I was being called that, I wasn't feeling very comfortable with myself. And just lately, actually, I've been made aware of the fact that Lilith Fair, obviously, is going to be a great, great example for young women out there. Just to show, I don't know, I had very few role models, female role models, when I was growing up, and I think this is a great opportunity to, you know, to celebrate the fact that women are finally having a voice. And and being listened to and loved and respected for it. So I don't feel so bad about being called a role model now. I don't know if that answered your question, though.
Certainly did. We'll come back to this window. Here's a song about love gone wrong, jilted love, denial, even a smattering of redemption. Path of Thorns, Terms, from Solace.
Terms of the light that you love.
Thank you.
Sarah McLachlan and band Intimate and Interactive in the Much Environment. Patrick Thorne. Sarah, we have a question for you here. What's your name? Where are you from?
I'm Barry. I'm from Toronto.
Question?
I know that you've taken a big hand in doing the design and the artwork for your album covers.
Yes.
And I was just wondering if you're going to do something more with your visual arts career.
Nothing in the near future. I'm pretty busy with the music thing and sort of my first and foremost love, but I've been very lucky that I've always been able to have a creative hand in either the process of making an album cover or of doing the videos. I've directed a few videos and had a lot of input in them. So, I don't know. It's, you know, talk to me later and talk to me in 10 years and I might have a completely different story for you, but I'm pretty sold on the music thing right now.
Can an idea become a song and a painting, for example?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. I think a lot of the energy and moods are very similar. One of the things I do to get rid of writer's block is paint. Because when I'm blocked in some place in my head, emotionally or creatively, if I paint, often that will open up those doors and you know, give me some sort of release. And that often, either the colors or the images or just the feelings that go into the painting, often I can feel in the music in a very similar way.
Cool. I have another question from Speaker's Corner, which is the world's first electronic soapbox, often imitated, never equaled. Let's go to Speaker's Corner on the road to Vancouver.
Let me show you something.
Listen carefully.
Hi, I'm Deanna. I'm on Kitts Beach in Vancouver. Both your music and your persona hint toward spirituality being a huge part of your life. I'm wondering how big a part it is and how it relates to your music.
That's a very good question and one that's rather difficult to answer. I think a big part of the process of my growing up has involved myself, me trying to figure out where my spiritual world lies. And I don't know if I practice any religion per se. I've never really studied much. My belief is that, you know, the word God, for instance, doesn't necessarily mean, oh, mighty he on high looking over us. It's more like God is me, God is you, God is these flowers, God is, it's energy. And we're all part of it, and we're all a creative force around it. And I think if we feel that connection, if we could feel more of that connection to the earth, we'd all be, I think, a lot happier. And the world would be happier, too, because we wouldn't be raping and pillaging it quite so much.
There you go.
There's my little rant for them.
Thank you.
Gotta respect the earth, or she's not gonna respect us.
What's your name? Where are you from?
And I'm from Winnipeg.
Hey.
This is for Ash. Yes, this is for Ash. Ash, I'm a drummer myself, and I'm finding it very hard to get a break. I was just wondering, how did you get started? How did you get started, and how are you keeping yourself up? And Sarah, can we see your ring?
Is there a connection?
On the spot.
Well, I got started when I was 7 years old, and I kind of knew when I was 7 years old exactly what I wanted to do, and I'm still trying to do it every day.
You do very fine at it.
Thanks.
If I don't say so.
So, yeah.
Okay. All right. Ash, show him the pants. Come on, show him the pants. Show him the pants.
I'm gonna kill you.
You have to have a certain attitude to do that. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
How about these pants, though?
Oh, yeah! Okay. We have an email question, if you'll look at the monitor just over here. Let's see what it is. Sarah, I've been a big fan of yours for years. One of the things I've always noticed in my artist is your down-to-earth, relaxed attitude. I'm wondering if you can handle the upheaval of being on tour, and what do you do to retain your sense of balance in your life when you're on the road?
Well, that's a great question. It's always kind of a problem for me. You know, if I could just be on the road for 6 months and then come home for a year, I think I'd be fine, but usually it tends to go on for much longer, and I often find that, like I said earlier, that I start to lose myself. So I've done a little bit of really good therapy this last year that has really helped me to have new skills to sort of deal with that kind of thing. And also there's this great little yoga exercise, which is amazing. You sit in your yoga position and you, I'm not sure of the fingers, yeah. But you breathe in four times one nostril and out 16, very slowly, do the same count, and then go to the other nostril, breathe in four counts, and then out 16. You do this for like 10 minutes, and it's amazing. And you just, you know, you could be completely wired and worked up and close to tears, and you know, it's a great way of releasing things without, you know, flying into a rage.
Very good. I feel better already. It's time for another performance here in the environment.
And I bring my dog.
Yes.
And we take our doggie everywhere with us. Her name is Rex, and she's a girl.
All right. A song certainly about families and perhaps about choices. This is Good Enough.
Hail the
Thank you. Thanks.
We have more of your questions, hopefully. We'll certainly have more music as Much Music presents Intimate and Interactive with Sarah McLachlan. Stay with us. Welcome back. We are Intimate and Interactive with Sarah McLachlan in Toronto. Here's a great song that I heard a couple of months ago. I've been singing it ever since. It's called Angel. It's from the brand new album called Surfacing. Sarah?
Spend all your time waiting for that second chance. Distraction, oh, beautiful release. Thank you.
Sarah McLachlan, Vince Jones. Vince has got a little Liberace vibe going there tonight. Great. I have to ask you about the song. It has such a haunting quality, but perhaps where you first saw something or heard something that kicked off the idea.
Oh, well, the initial inspiration came from a Rolling Stone article about heroin in the music industry and about the fellow, the keyboard player from the Smashing Pumpkins who had OD'd, and about the just the abuse of the drug in the industry. And I wrote it trying to put myself into that person's shoes, you know, trying to realize how someone gets so lost. And then I very quickly realized the song was completely about me. As I wrote it, it was revealing itself to be, you know, holding up this total mirror to me. And I've never done heroin, but I can understand being really lost, being on the road and losing yourself and all that, and then just, God, give me some distraction, give me anything to free myself from the crap that I'm feeling right now. I don't have time to deal with this now. And, you know, so I understand that allure.
Okay, thank you for that. Leanne, are you still with us?
Yeah, hi.
Leanne, tell me you're there.
I'm here.
Hi, thank you. At least it's not long distance, all right.
Okay, how are you, Sarah?
I'm good, how are you?
Oh, I'm great.
How's she look?
She looks great.
Doesn't she?
I like your hair.
Thanks. <It's laughs>
I was wondering who your musical influences are.
Now or early on?
Like, all together.
Oh, okay. Well, I'd have to say some of the people who most influenced my songwriting are people like Cat Stevens, Simon and Garfunkel, Joan Baez, Mary O'Hara, because those are my really early influences that I listened to for years, and I think really gave me a strong melodic sense and a sense and a story writing thing. Lately, I've been listening, well, the past, I guess, 10 years, Peter Gabriel, Willie Nelson, Ricky Lee Jones, Joni Mitchell, Annie Lennox is a huge influence. Emmylou Harris's new record, Wrecking Ball, was just awesome. I had to take it off, actually. I started sounding like her. I was singing the songs a little too much. So.
Okay.
Thanks, Leanne.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks for hanging in there. Hi, what's your name?
My name's Michelle.
Where are you from?
Montreal.
Hello.
Question?
Bonjour.
No, I'm English. Thanks. Okay. Not that there's
how do you
wrong
feel about separatism?
Wait, let's start over. Okay.
Faux pas.
Well, first off, I want to say that you're a very, very big influence in my life and in my songwriting also. And I really appreciate your music so much and thank you for it. I heard that early on in your career you had to provide a lot of funding for your own, for your videos or for your recording, something like that. I was wondering, you had friends in your videos and things like how, when did it turn over and become really
about a year and a half? Well, as far as funding, I mean, being on an independent label, I'm on Network, which is an independent record company in Vancouver, and they're a great label. I love them dearly, and they've always been very supportive, but for years we did have very limited funding, but we got, as a one of the good things about being a Canadian musician is there's Factor grants and you get money from the government to help you out to make videos and stuff like that. So, I did have a lot of my friends in my videos, but that was more just choice. I like being surrounded with the people I'm close to. So, I guess I broke even about the end of the second year of touring for Fumbling. Before that, I had like a $400,000 debt that just kept piling up and piling up. But so it took a while. I mean, I've had bands come up to me who've been on tour for 3 weeks and go, oh, I don't know if I can deal with this. It's so tough being on the road. When am I going to start making money? And I'm like, well, it's been 8 years for me, darling. But I'm doing great now, so I'm very happy.
We have a speaker's corner question on the road from Halifax.
Oh,
here we go.
Hometown.
All right.
Hi, Sarah. My name's Jason. I'm here in Halifax. I just had a question about the Lilith Fair. The fair is touring Canada this summer, but you're not stopping in Atlantic Canada, which is where you're originally from, and I'm just wondering why.
Oh, dear. Well, the trouble is that there's no venue to play in Halifax. There's no venue anywhere around the Maritimes. Like, we'd have to come, like, from Montreal and go all the way there to play one show where there's really no venue for the way we're set up, because we need amphitheaters. We're not going into big venues and setting up stages for the most part. So, and it just, it wasn't feasible. The lineup, I'm looking myself into a corner here, but the lineup is such that we have to pay everybody so much, and I don't think we'd lose a whole scad of money. But I am coming.
All right.
In October to Halifax, okay. And to the Maritimes, and I will be all playing right. A full two-hour show then.
Excellent. Yeah. we've touched on Lilith there a bit, but please tell us about the original thought.
Oh, there's so many reasons for it.
I know. And it's so painfully obvious.
Well, it's very timely. There's a lot of incredible talent out there that I felt really wasn't getting represented in the, you know, the touring aspect of things, and it was very selfish as well, because I rarely get to see any of the people I love play live, and I thought, wouldn't it be great to put together a festival of all these women who are cropping up, who are simply amazing, and it's a bit reactionary. I mean, 3 or 4 years ago, if we had tried to do this, we would have gotten laughed at, because, well, it was simply unheard of. I mean, they were still having trouble with two women playing back to back on the radio. You know, we were all being so marginalized, and so this is a celebration of the fact that women in the music business finally have a really strong voice, a beautiful, compassionate, diverse voice that people are listening to, and I think that's a huge reason to celebrate.
And men are invited.
And men are invited. Men are welcome. I really hope to open up some eyes, maybe, you know, maybe, and I just realized this, now this is very naive of me, but I had a lot of guys lately going, it's a great place to meet women. I never even thought of that, but well, yes, it is. I really want men to feel comfortable coming to this. It's not at all about alienating men, it's simply about celebrating the fact that women are beautiful and talented and go on, excellent, you know, it's great. Men should want to celebrate that.
All right.
And someday, I hope to see Lilith Fair have some longevity, and we'd like to include men on the bill at some point down the line as well.
Excellent.
Yeah.
We have one of those guys out there. His name is Sean. He's in Grand Prairie, Alberta. Sean, what's your question?
Yes, Sarah, I'd just like to say that you are very beautiful and very talented.
Thank you.
And my question is, when you decide to write or find a time to write, what sort of place do you look to find your inner self and to be able to pour out your passions into your beautiful and creative songs?
Oh, a big part of songwriting for me is focus, and being calm and centered is very, very important. So I really have to say a lot of my songwriting process on the last record was therapy. And just getting myself balanced and centered and finding myself again. And usually when I'm in that place of being really strong and centered, the songs come out really, really easily.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Sean.
Thanks.
Okay, we're going to take a break. Okay. Get ready, call the band together, and have some more music and some more questions. We are Intimate and Interactive with Sarah McLachlan in the Mush Environment. Much environment tonight here in Toronto. Sarah McLachlan's in from Vancouver. We're on Queen Street. What's your name?
Laura.
Where are you from?
Scarborough.
Okay, what's your question?
Okay, these days music has been categorized and subcategorized into so many different titles. So my question to you is, what would you personally categorize your music under, if any at all?
I try very hard not to, just for that very reason. I find most categories pigeonhole music and are very marginalizing, because usually music is about way more than what they're calling it. typically. So, yeah, I've got all sorts of influences. I have pop influences, I have folk influences, I have soul influences, and I try to create a hybrid of all those. So, gosh, I don't know. I don't know what to call it. I always do, when people ask me that, I always just say, well, just listen to it and
judge
that, hopefully that'll answer your question. Yeah.
Thanks, Sarah. Thank you very much. Seeing as how we're already out on Queen Street, why don't we go around the corner and do a live speaker's corner right over there.
Hi, Sarah.
Hi.
I was just wondering if, I know you grew up in a classical music atmosphere with your parents and who had a lot of influence on you. I'm just wondering if you're ever considering going back to classical music at all in the future.
I doubt it very much. I felt that classical music was actually a bit stifling for me. I mean, I learned an awful lot as far as melody and chord progression and harmony and theory and whatnot, but I sort of felt like I got what I needed out of it and moved into the kind of music that I really love and enjoy to play. Although I enjoy listening to some classical music, but as far as playing it, I don't know. Nah. I'm not disciplined enough.
Okay.
You need to practice 10 hours a day, and it's...
Speaking of practicing, I have a quick question. I hear that when you were in Halifax growing up, you were an ace skateboarder. Is that true?
I rode the half pipe quite a lot.
Excellent.
I did.
Not these days, though.
No.
No, I don't think so. Okay.
That's in my contract.
Okay, Celeste is on the phone. Celeste, where are you phoning from?
Victoria, B.C.
Welcome.
Thanks.
Hi.
Hi, Sarah. I just wanted to say quickly that your music has helped me through some really tough times, and I'd like to thank you for that. I was wondering if you wrote the song Shelter because of your involvement with World Vision, or if it had anything to do with that at all.
Actually, I wrote that song before I took that trip. It's actually roughly based on a tape I saw, a vivisection tape, but scientific testing on animals and the horror of realizing that whole thing. And it didn't have anything to do with the Thailand Cambodia trip.
Okay, thank you.
No problem.
Okay. Performance. What do we got? Hold on.
Okay.
You ready?
Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you. Beautiful. I'm over here. We have a question over on this side of the room. What's your name? Where are you from?
I'm Calvin from Toronto. Mm-hmm. And from listening to your songs for over about 3 years, I've noticed that you can sing a very high and wide range with your soothing voice. So as someone who likes to sing myself, I was wondering, how many octaves can you sing?
And could you show us now, of course?
I think 2.5 or something like that.
Is it?
Yeah, I'll start squeak up there, so I don't know. Two and a bit, something like that.
Has it changed?
Yeah, it's gotten a lot lower. I've gained like 3 whole notes down. I've lost the high stuff because I don't go there too much anymore.
Oh, okay, don't go there.
I have to practice if I really...
I have a fax, but okay. I can't tell you where it's from because even in the small print it doesn't say. It says, Dear Sarah, at what point in your life did you realize your calling? Thank you, your loving fans, Jean Truesdale, Lillian Perez, and Rachel Olison.
Well, basically, I've been singing all my life, and it's been pretty much the biggest solace for me throughout my life. I suppose, back to the classical thing, I did a lot of classical recitals when I was young, and if that doesn't ruin you for music, I don't know what does. Sometimes, because they're quite traumatic. You have to sit there with all the other parents, and they don't care if you do good. As a matter of fact, they want you to fail because they want their kids to do good. And it's a lot of pressure. I hated them. And the first gig I ever played, I had a band called The October Game. It wasn't my band, it was a band I joined. And the first gig we ever played, we were up on stage. It was the Dalhousie Sub in Halifax. There was about 400 people there. And we were playing music that the band had written and a few covers. And it was the most exciting feeling I had ever felt in my life. So I'd say that's when I realized my true calling, that this was exactly what I wanted to do and where I wanted to be. And that, curiously enough, was where Mark Jowett Network saw me and wanted to sign me. Yeah, so it was, and I was 17, and my parents freaked out, so that didn't happen. But.
Hey, wait a couple of years.
Yeah, they waited.
All right.
I'm very lucky for that.
The monitor up here, some email has come in. Can you say that you've come to a point in your life where you are satisfied with your career, or are you expecting to do bigger and better things? And as far as I'm concerned, you've already made it. And anything else you do is icing on the cake.
Oh, that's very sweet. I feel very, very blessed and lucky to be where I am at 29. I've sort of achieved so many of the dreams that I set out for myself. And I'd say that Lilith Fair is probably going to be the bigger and better thing. I mean, this is something that is becoming really, really huge and has much more to do than with just me. It's all these women, and it's a great feeling to be a part of that. And I think that's going to be something really huge.
It has taken on a life of its own, hasn't it?
Yeah,
oh,
I think
so. Can't wait for it to happen. We have a phone call, I think, from John. Hello. Yellow. Julie.
Oh, hi. Yeah, this
is
Julie. Julie from Cleveland, Ohio.
Hi there.
Hi, Sarah. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Pretty good. I have a question for you, being recently married myself. I was wondering, how does having your husband in the band affect the band as well as your marriage?
Well, it's a darn good thing because I'm pretty needy.
Is that right?
I'm needy. And it's fantastic having him on the road with me. He's a huge support.
Well, terrific.
I love him so much, and I don't think I could be out here if he wasn't out here with me, so.
Well, great.
Just to get cornball for a second.
And also, that in part also applies to the songwriting. I mean, you're writing about dark things, but you have a rock there to help
you. Oh, yeah.
Out.
It's very true that it would have been a lot harder for me, I think, to write the record that I did without having the support of that quite unconditional love that he gives me. It's amazing.
Hey, Sarah, will you do Witness for us?
Yes.
Here's a song from the new album called Surfacing. It is so fine. This is Witness.
Thank you.
Man, I hope you can feel the vibe. It's a great song, and there's more to come. We are Intimate and Interactive with Sarah McLachlan and Much Music. Welcome back to the Much Environment here in Toronto. Intimate Interactive with Sarah. I was just telling Sarah that, that when you do your note and you do your note and you will woo at the same time, I lose my sense of balance. It's a weird note here. What's your name? Where are you from?
I'm Christine and I'm from Sweden.
Welcome to Canada.
Thank you.
You have a question for Sarah?
Yes. I'm asking you if you, when you're going to receive your record in Sweden, if you're going to receive your record in Sweden.
Oh, if I'm going to release one there.
Yeah.
Actually, I did a bit of a promotional trip in Scandinavia 2 years ago. So I think I know Fumbling's out. I don't know when Servicing is probably going to come out a little later in Europe, but it will be out for sure. Probably in the late fall, maybe. Yeah.
The whole
but if you wait around long enough, you can get it here. I don't know how long you're here for.
The whole world will fall to their knees. World domination. We have a speaker's corner on the road question from Montreal. If you look at the monitor, maybe we can answer it. Here we go.
Now, let's listen.
Bonjour, Sarah. My name is Jean-Marc. I'm from Montreal, and I would like to know, how did you get involved with Léonard Peltier case?
Léonard Peltier, yes.
Well, actually, who's a good friend of mine from Blue Rodeo, made me aware of the whole situation. I had heard of a long time ago, sort of in the periphery of my existence, but it was when I was very young, and it went away for a long time, and I think it's great that it's been brought to the forefront again, and this fellow has been wrongly accused of killing some FBI agents and has been in jail for years and years and years, and I think they even have proof that he didn't do it, but it's such an embarrassment now that they're just trying to shove it under the carpet, and Greg Keeler wanted to get together a benefit record to try and raise awareness and support for Léonard Peltier, and so that's how I became involved.
And Greg's here tonight.
Greg Keeler is here tonight.
Is here tonight. Way to go, Greg.
Hi, Greg.
Okay. Let's go to Scott on the phone. Scott, where are you calling from?
Thompson.
Thompson, Manitoba.
Yeah.
Fire away.
Yeah. Hi, Sarah.
Hi.
I don't want to get your husband mad or anything, but you look really good tonight. And my question is, you've got a really good website, and I've seen your CD-ROM, and I just wanted to know how you got involved in that kind of multimedia stuff.
Well, Terry McBride, the president of Network Records, and my manager, has been always at the forefront of multimedia and computers and everything, and he was the one who pushed us forward to do the first multimedia CD thing for the Freedom Sessions, and that was one of the first ones that actually came out. So he was sort of the instigator of all that, and quite honestly, I was a bit unsure about the whole thing, and he forced Seisha and said, this is going to be really good, it's going to be a really huge thing. And then I went on the road, and actually some people at home did all the compiling of information, put this thing together, and I went home and went, wow, this is amazing what you can do. It was very cool.
Yeah, let's give a big nod to the people back at Network in Vancouver,
mm-hmm.
The whole interactive
device, yeah.
The whole of them.
They're fantastic. They've got a great web page. They put
absolutely
together really good
the
stuff.
Design department. Now, I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
After, here I am leaping already, you're not even there yet, after Lilith and after Surfacing has died down, then what for you personally?
Well, I think we're going to probably try and have a baby. We're going to travel. We're going to go to India and or Africa and sort of just be leisure for a while and then, try and get pregnant.
Excellent.
Yeah. I'm almost 30, you know, so the clock's ticking big time.
Okay. We have an email here.
Okay.
It's, with your active participation in promotional Lilith Fair, as well as the decidedly feminine feeling of your body of work, considering that the new album is named Servicing. What, if any, debt or influence does Margaret Atwood hold for you?
Good question. You know, I thought of the name Servicing completely separate from Margaret Atwood. It came to me one night, and it just seemed absolutely perfect, and the metaphor sort of came with it of the dark lake and everything that I was going through to make the record. And about a week into it, I realized, wait a minute, that's a Margaret Atwood novel. And so, and I actually read that book when I was, I think, 15 or 16. And then I came back to it and went and realized that it's about a woman who goes into the woods in northern Quebec to find her father. And I thought, oh, there's another similarity. But I should have actually finished reading the book, but I haven't. It's on the bathroom. On the, so every time I'm going to get out of the bathroom, I read one page and then put it down. So I haven't gotten very far. But... But she's a fantastic writer, and I have to say that a lot of her later books, which I've read as an adult, have really influenced me. They're cool. Beautiful, beautiful writing.
Thank you. I have a question over here. What's your name? Where are you from?
I'm Rosalyn. I'm from Mississauga. Hi, Sarah.
Hi.
I was wondering about the writing process for Servicing. I understand that for writing for Fumbling, you went away out of the city or whatever to mm-hmm. get away from it all. And write in almost solitude. I was wondering if you went through that for Servicing.
I did pretty much the same thing. It was a different cottage, but it was in the same woods. It was in the Laurentians in Quebec again, outside of Morin Heights. I was there for about 8 months. And that was a very necessary thing. I'm very easily distracted. So for me, I have to go and be by myself. And I was talking earlier about, you know, forcing the solitude and forcing myself to be in a place where I can be really calm and centered. And the country for me really does that because I feel I become really connected again with the earth. And that's, again, one of the most important things that we lose a lot of living in the city. It's very hard surrounded by steel and concrete to feel a part of the earth that you can't even see beneath your feet. So it's very necessary for me to go away.
I have about a minute left. Let me ask you this one. Fans, adulation, they tell you how much they love you. Someone there at the window said they loved your back. How do you deal with that? Do you at times argue with yourself as to whether you deserve that?
Oh, yeah. God, near the end of Surfacing, near the end of Fumbling and near the end of Solace, when I was on the road for too long, I would actually get angry at people. Not to their face, but afterwards, because they'd be telling me how fantastic it was. And I felt horrible about myself. And so I didn't feel like I deserved it. And I said, what is wrong with you? Can't you see how messed up I am? But I feel very strong right now. I feel very ready for whatever's going to come at me.
Good. Yeah. Let's leave with music rather than talk. How about saying goodbye to Sarah McLachlan?
Thanks for coming.
Thank you. Thanks, Ben. That was awesome.
Now, you know that people have been phoning throughout the show, to actually join you in Vancouver for Lilith Fair, and you know they've been calling like crazy. One trip for two to Lilith Fair, the finale in Vancouver, yep. At Thunderbird Stadium, August 24. You know it'll be emotional, and the winner is.
Which one is it?
It'll be this one.
Here. Carrie Blackwell of London, Ontario.
Congratulations. Would you introduce the band?
Yes. This is Sean Ashby on electric guitar.
Hey, Sean!
Ashwin Sood on drums. Brian Minotto on bass. Vince Jones on keyboards. Camille Henderson on vocals. And David Sinclair on electric and acoustic guitars.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you for your music. Thank you.
Bye-bye.